This morning we have a guest preacher. His name is Jacob Birch. He started out his ministry at Guildwood Presbyterian and now is the pastor and has been for 2 years of the congregation that meets in the afternoon, the West Rouge Valley Group. So we welcome you this morning, Jake. He has been here before. And if you attended the concert a few weeks ago, Jake's wife did an amazing performance on the piano. Just beautiful work. I'd like to have her back again. Let us prepare our hearts for worship. God's word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. God's word is made visible in Christ. In him we are rooted in truth. God's word is revealed through the Holy Spirit. Come and listen for God's word in this time of worship.
Let's bow our heads and our hearts for the prayer of adoration, and then we'll recite together the prayer of confession. But first, let us pray. God of wisdom, you are the light of the minds that know you, the strength of those who serve you, and rest for those who seek you. God of growth, you sow and you gather, you tend and you prune, you judge and you save. God who tends our lives, we come to you in worship, to rest from our responsibilities, to turn from our distractions, and to hand over our concerns to you. Nourish us with your word so that we grow in Christ, rooted in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Faithful God, you have planted the seeds of faith in us, but we confess that we have not tended those seeds well. We fail to keep studying your word, satisfied instead with what we think it means. We consider what we already know. Please let's stand together for the prayer of confession. Faithful God, you have planted the seeds of faith in us, but we confess we have not tended those seeds well. We fail to keep studying your word, satisfied instead with what we think it means. We consider that we already know enough, rather than pursue deeper encounters with you. Forgive us, God, when we think you have nothing more to offer us. Amen. Please be seated. The Apostle Paul reminds us that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. God's Spirit sets us free from the powers of sin and death. Know that you are forgiven, and forgive one another in Jesus' name. Well, for today's God's Word Illustrated, do we have any children here in the room with us? Oh, we've got some young at heart people. We've got some young at heart people. Amazing. All right. Well, I'm going to be talking in this sermon about the importance of God working in our hearts. And so I thought for today's God's Word Illustrated, we would look at Acts 16, verse 32. Where we read this about David, that after removing Saul, God made David their king. God testified concerning him, I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do. So one question for all of us here today, maybe there are some children online, maybe you might want to type it. Are we on Zoom or on YouTube, DJ? We're on Zoom. You might want to type it in the Zoom chat. What's one thing, and you go ahead, young at heart here in the room, you yell out too, what's one thing you love about what you're wearing today? What's one thing you love about what you're wearing, about your external? What do you like about what you're wearing today? Your flowers, you got flowered blouse. Is that's a blouse? It's your blouse, right, it's a flowered blouse. Amazing, all right, somebody else, what do you love about what you're wearing today? Your fabric, all right, is that a nice fabric to wear on a humid day? Yes, you hope so. All right, someone else. Yes, in the back. Your color. Yes, I think we all love that color. I wish I could get away with that color. Yes, all right, somebody else, what do you love? Yes. She's wearing, or they're wearing their favorite color. Excellent, thank you very much for responding. All right, very good. Now, not thinking about your clothes, but thinking about your body, once again, about your outside. What do you love? Not about, but we're trying to get a little bit more insight here. What do you love about just the way you're looking these days? Do you love your haircut? Maybe you really appreciate your eye color. Maybe you've got a great pedicure. I live with three women, and they're always walking down the hill to the beauty store to get their hair done, their nails done, their toes done. What is it you love about something a little bit, not just your clothes, but your body itself? What are you loving these days? Yes. Your haircut, excellent. I know, very humble. Nobody wants to brag. I'll get to the one everyone likes to do in just a moment. All right. Anybody online, what do you love about your body? Not about your clothes, something about your external body you love right now. All right, your skin cleared up finally. Yes, over here. Your height. All right. I won't ask you how tall you are, but that's wonderful. Yes, I'm 6'3" and a bit, and I've always enjoyed being tall. All right. Now, here's the one we all love. What do you not like about your external body right now? What is it you wish you could change? Maybe it's your hair. Maybe it's your whatever. What is it that you wish you could change? Shana needs a haircut for real, she says. All right. All right. Here our brother wishes he could have a haircut. Yes. All right. Yes, ma'am. You wish you were taller. Yes, my family, we stayed at a cottage a couple weeks ago up north, and it must have been owned by hobbits previously. And I think what they actually did was they turned all of the outside porches into bedrooms. And so all of the doors from the now bedrooms, what used to be porches, into the house were all very low. And I got up at 3 a.m. with my dogs, and I whacked my head so hard on one of the lintels of the doors because they were a little low. So there are some advantages to being short. So maybe as much as I love being tall, the thing I would like to change is it would be nice to just be a little bit shorter, I think. Anybody else? What would you like to change? Yes, ma'am. No, not you. Okay, in blue. A singing voice. Oh, yeah, amazing. All right, anybody online? Yes. All right, take off 25 years and 25 pounds. Can I get agreement on that? Who'd agree on that one here today? I know you're Presbyterian, not used to raising your hands, but all right, maybe you and me both, brother, you and me both. All right, somebody in the back? I think I saw a hand out in the ushers. Oh, she would like a singing voice as well. There we go. Shannon's offering lessons, it appears now. What night of the week for lessons? Oh, any Thursday, if you want a singing voice, Shannon will work with you. Well, this is the thing. We judge ourselves, we judge other people so much by how we look, by how tall or how short, by the color of our skin, by the kind of clothes we wear. The people of Israel were actually misled a little bit by Saul. He was tall. He looked the part of being king. But as Acts 16:33 makes clear, even though he looked the part, he wasn't a king in his heart. So when David had opportunity, when God had opportunity to, through Samuel, select the next king of Israel, he looked for someone who was a king in their heart, someone who would always put the needs of the people first. And that's why young David, even though David was forgotten, you know, it's interesting. David was the eighth of eight brothers. And when Samuel told David's father, go get your sons because one of them will be king, even David's own father left him behind, thinking David would never be the one chosen. He was too young. He was too this. He was too that. There was nothing on the outside of him that said king. But God wasn't looking on the outside anymore. He was looking at the heart. And in his heart, God knew that David was the man to be king. So if you wake up, if you go to school, if you go to VBS, if you come to sing on Thursday nights and you don't sound the best, you feel you don't look the best, if people judge you for how short or how tall or what color you are or what color you aren't, I want you to remember that God always starts with our hearts. That's what he's looking for. If you've got a heart right with God, then you're on the right track to being used by him in this world in a mighty and powerful way. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we pray for the young people of this church and the young at heart, that you'd help us, Lord, to worry most not about how we look or about how we deal with all the external things. Help us, Lord, to be right in our hearts with you. Help us to come to that place where we accept you, Lord Jesus, into our lives. We follow you. We walk for you and with you. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your word, which guides us on this path of having right hearts with you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Morning, everyone. The first reading is from Ezra, chapter 1, and I'm reading from the New International Version. Cyrus helps the exiles to return. In the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah, the Lord moved the heart of Cyrus, king of Persia, to make a proclamation throughout his realm and to put it in writing. This is what Cyrus, king of Persia, says: "The Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has appointed me to build a temple for him at Jerusalem in Judah. Any one of his people among you, may his God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem in Judah and build the temple of the Lord, the God of Israel, the God who is in Jerusalem. And the people of any place where survivors may now be living are to provide him with silver and gold, with goods and livestock, and with freewill offerings for the temple of God in Jerusalem. Then the family heads of Judah and Benjamin, and the priests and the Levites, anyone whose heart God had moved, prepared to go up and build the house of the Lord in Jerusalem. All their neighbors assisted them in the articles of silver and gold, with goods and livestock, and with valuable gifts, in addition to all the free will offerings. Moreover, King Cyrus brought out the articles belonging in the temple of the Lord, which Nebuchadnezzar had carried away from Jerusalem and had placed them in the temple of his God. Cyrus, king of Persia, had them brought to Mithridates, the treasurer, who counted them out to Shesbazar, the prince of Judah. This was the inventory: gold dishes 30, silver dishes 1,000, silver pans 29, gold bowls 30, matching gold silver bowls 410, other articles 1,000. In all, there were 5,400 articles of gold and of silver. Shesbazar brought all of these along when the exiles came up from Babylon to Jerusalem." And the second reading is Luke chapter 15, 11 to 32. The parable of the lost son. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all that he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called to one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, come home, you kill the fattened calf for him. My son, the father said, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. This is the word of the Lord.
So I'm a father, and my wife Heather and I are about to be grandparents for the first time. Our son and his wife are going to have their first child this coming September. And so I just wonder this morning if I can start off with a couple dad jokes for you. Because I come by them honestly. Are we good with that? We'll try. They're all about heart, because that's what we're going to be talking about today from Ezra 1. Why did the Valentine get arrested for stealing someone's heart? What did one volcano say to the other on Valentine's Day? I lava you with all my heart. Right, dad jokes. Why did the skeleton refuse to propose to his girlfriend? Because his heart wasn't in it. All right, okay, last one. What's the cheesiest pickup line for bakers to use? Honey, you have a piece of all my heart. Well, in Ezra chapter 1, God begins to restart the nation of Israel. Not by giving them a new geography, not by giving them a new army, not by giving them a new king. God doesn't restart the nation of Israel by doing anything external. What do we read? That God worked first in the heart of Cyrus and the heart of the Jewish leaders. Let's remember for a moment a bit of our biblical history. So we're gonna be moving time this way for you. 1250 BC, Moses leads the people in the Exodus out of Egypt and into the Promised Land. About 1000 BC is when David and Solomon reign. That's the part of the passage I read earlier about David being a man after God's own heart. Then in 586 BC, Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonians, come and destroy the temple in Jerusalem. And the people of Israel are carted off into exile. So there are two big E's in the Old Testament. One of them is Exodus. Moses leads the people out of Egypt. Then they have their own nation for a while. And then in 586 BC, the temple is destroyed. The city of Jerusalem is destroyed. And the Babylonians take the people into the second big E of the Old Testament, of exile. And our passage that was so wonderfully read this morning for us by Cassie from Ezra 1 is from 458, basically, 120 years later. For 120 years, there was no temple. There was no nation of Israel. There was no city of Jerusalem. But for the first time in three generations, God is going to restart his people again. They had been living this whole time as exiles in the empire first of Babylon, and then the Babylonian Empire was taken over by the Assyrian Empire. So for two different political administrations, they had had nothing. They had had no king, they had had no army, they had had no temple, they had had no city. They weren't even allowed to eat their own food, the book of Daniel makes clear to us. They weren't allowed to speak their own language for the most part, except at home. But when God's restart begins, he begins in each of our hearts. Look back at Ezra chapter 1, verse 1. In the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah, listen to what it says here, Ezra 1, the Lord moved the heart of Cyrus, king of Persia, to make a proclamation throughout his realm and also to put it in writing. And that's what was read, that he was going to allow the people of Israel to go from Babylon and then Assyria back to their homeland in Israel. That when God wants his restart to begin, he begins not with an external, no, he begins in each of our hearts. You'll always sense something internal before you see something external. And you know, I think a little bit coming out of COVID, our churches are in this same kind of situation where we're trying to restart them. We're trying to see people come back who've been so used to worshiping online, or people who've stopped worshiping at all, maybe fell to the wayside. We're trying to say, hey, come be part of Melville Presbyterian Church again. Come be part of Rouge Valley Church again. And if we want to see God restart what he's been doing here amongst us for many years, it's going to restart in each one of our hearts. You know, the word in Ezra here translated heart is the word ruach, often translated spirit. It's interesting that when God started the world, what do we read? And the earth was formless and without void, and a void, darkness was over the face of the deep, and the spirit, the ruach, the heart of God was moving upon the face of the waters. That same word translated spirit or heart is there in Genesis 1:2. When God started the whole world, he did it by having his own heart, his own spirit there over the waters. It's the spirit, the ruach, the heart of Pharaoh that was first troubled to begin Joseph's redemption from prison. Genesis 41:8, in the morning, Pharaoh's mind was troubled. The word there translated mind is the word ruach or heart. So he sent for all the magicians and wise men of Egypt, and Pharaoh told them his dreams, but no one could interpret them. When God wanted to restart Joseph's fortunes, he moved in Pharaoh's heart. The spirit, the ruach, the heart of Moses was first shared with the elders of Israel to begin them sharing the burden of leadership with him. In Numbers 11:17, what do we read? Moses writing, he says, I will come down and speak with you there, and I will take some of the power of the ruach, the spirit, some of your heart that is on you, and I'll put it on them. They will share the burden of the people with you, Moses, so that you will not have to carry it alone. God always starts with our hearts. What was he restarting in Ezra 1? He was restarting the Jewish nation back in the land of Israel. Ezra 1 notes that everything we're about to read was to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah the prophet. When the people had first been taken by Nebuchadnezzar over to Babylon and then Assyria, they had actually written back in the very early days, maybe the first year or so after being taken away in exile, there were Jews living in Babylon, and there were the poorest of Jews, among them Jeremiah the prophet, living still back in the ruins of the city. And so the people in Babylon wrote to Jeremiah and said, should we get ready to come back? Is God going to restart us right now? And then in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, is Jeremiah's response. And this is part of that response. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good purpose to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. You may have heard that verse before. Verse 12, then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me, here comes the word, and find me when you seek me with all your heart, Jeremiah says. So decades before, the people had been told that this restart was going to happen, not when they changed their geography, not when they changed their politics, not when they changed their worship or their language or anything external, that God's restart was going to happen when their hearts began to change. God's restart begins in each one of our hearts. The greatest restart story Jesus ever told was also read for us this morning from Luke chapter 15. It's the parable that's called the parable of the lost son. I really think it should be entitled the parable of the lost sons, because both sons were lost, though in different ways. What do we read in Luke 15, 17, kind of one of the first big moments? The son has asked his father for half his assets and basically telling his dad that his dad is better off dead to him. So he takes half his assets, and the father loses not only half his wealth, he also loses the labor of the son. So it's a kind of double loss. And the son takes that and squanders it. And then he ends up having to hire himself out as a debt slave in a foreign land. And he's in the pigsty, which would have been an unclean place for a young Jewish man to be. And it's there in the pigsty that we read this verse, Luke 15, 17, as was read this morning. When the young son came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. The young son has a change, not of his location, he's still in the pigsty, not of his clothing, not of anything else. What changes first is his heart. He remembers how well his father treated, not even his sons, how he was treated, but how well his father treated his servants. So his restart happened by God moving in his heart. That's why we're saying today from Ezra 1 that God's restart always begins in each of our hearts. But back to Ezra. Notice that before he works in our hearts, where does God work? In his own heart. Ezra 1:5. Then the family heads of Judah and Benjamin and the priests and Levites, everyone whose heart God had moved. Right? So the family heads have their hearts moved, but who moves them? God does. So our restart really starts in God's heart. Look at their externals in Ezra. They were living in a foreign land. Nothing about that had changed yet. Even when they moved back to Jerusalem, it was still under control of the Assyrians. They were having to speak a foreign language. Most of the book of Ezra is basically like a chain email of people from Jerusalem sending letters to Babylon, and people in Babylon sending letters back, and all of those letters are not written in Hebrew, the language of the Jews, they're written in Aramaic. So their language wasn't changed. They were so far from home, they were a three-month journey across the desert. That hadn't changed. They didn't have a temple. Their capital city didn't have a wall. They didn't have a priesthood. They weren't offering the sacrifices, all of these things. But what did they have? What did God change? All they really had were their hearts that still longed to serve God. And so what did God start with? He started with those willing hearts. That's why I'm saying today from Ezra 1 that if we want to see Rouge Valley Church or Melville Presbyterian Church restarted and begin to grow again, it's not going to happen when we change all of our externals. Well, what we need is really a third screen. Amen, DJ? Right? No, not really, right? We got two and that was just enough. I was interesting. I was at a an event this week where another minister was talking, and he said that the big debate in their church was whether or not to put up one screen, let alone two, all right? And I thought to myself, because I knew I was going to be speaking on this, oh, it's not about screens or their number. It's not about, as important as it is and as glad as we were to try and help you raise money for your air conditioning and your furnace, that will be an important change, but that's not going to be part of restarting your church, as much as it will be great to worship in an air-conditioned building, and we want to be part of helping fund that, Melville Presbyterian Church. All of these externals are important, but they're not the place that God starts. If your church is going to restart, it's going to be because God begins working in our hearts. God works from the inside out. So how do you know? How will you begin to know as a church that God is working amongst you to restart things? Well, I think there's at least three little observations we can make from Ezra 1. Number one, that when God begins to work, it always brings him glory first. It won't be about me or Bethany or the session or your amazing technology or your great worship. No, when God begins to work, it will bring him glory first. Look what Cyrus writes to the people back there in Ezra chapter 1, verse 2. This is what Cyrus, king of Persia, says. And remember, let's remember, Cyrus is a Zoroastrian. He's a worshiper of the stars. He is a pagan king, an emperor. He's had his thumb, his boot, on the Jewish people, subjugating their worship, their language, their dietary laws, all these things. And yet, what do we read? Verse 2. This is what Cyrus, king of Persia, says, the Lord, his very first word, is the personal name of the Jewish God. The Lord, the God of heaven. He then recognizes that the personal God of the Jewish people is the God of all the heavens. This is a man who worships the heavens. He realizes that it's the God of heaven who's moving in his life. Has given me, he then says, all the kingdoms of the earth. Those are three things. When you're the emperor of Persia, you should never say. You should never use the personal name of a people you've subjugated. You should never then claim that subjugated people, and by definition God, are above your gods. And you should never use the idea that you've been given anything. No, you're the emperor. You're King Cyrus. You take things. You make things happen. But no, when God works, it always brings him glory, as we see in Ezra chapter 1, verse 2. Reminds me of what Jesus said in Mark and Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. But seek first his kingdom, Jesus says to his followers, and his righteousness, and all this will be added unto you as well. How will you know that God is working in your heart? When it's so clearly him, he so clearly deserves all the glory. Secondly, how will you know it's him working in your heart? Well, secondly, the thing that God does is he builds your team. All of a sudden, you won't need that slide that says, hey, we need someone to go and work with the children. God will begin to bring people. That's the second thing that happens in the book of Ezra, that he not only brings himself glory, he begins to build the people's, brings the people together. Verse 5 of Ezra 1, then the family heads, plural, of Judah and Benjamin, and the priests and the Levites, listen to what it says here, everyone whose heart God had moved, prepared to go up and build the house of the Lord in Jerusalem. All their neighbors, verse 6, assisted them with articles of silver and gold, with goods and livestock, and with valuable gifts, in addition to all the free will offerings. The second thing God does after bringing himself glory when he begins to restart is he brings us together. You know, COVID has been so hard on so many churches, right? It's been tough because some of us have wanted to wear a mask and others have wanted to stop wearing masks. You know, some Some have wanted to meet online. It's wonderful that we do this now, and others have pushed for us to meet in person. Some have wanted to do this, and others wanted to do that, and it's been very hard on a lot of churches. The numbers I've heard as I've traveled around are 30 flat 50, that most churches are down 30% in attendance, that most churches, though interesting, are flat in money, but what they're really struggling with is 30 flat 50. Most churches have found a 50% reduction in the number of volunteers they have, of people got out of the habit of volunteering and haven't come back to volunteering again. Well, when God begins to work, you'll begin to see that the second thing he'll do after bring himself glory is he'll begin to build your team. He'll begin to pull you together, and pray for that, Melville, and pray for us for that at Rouge Valley as well. And lastly, when God begins to work, it leads to generosity. Before they leave for Judah, before they fast, before they put one single stone on another in Jerusalem, what happens? Well, I just read that not only did God bring their neighbors together and have their neighbors in favor of what they're doing, their neighbors were generous. Their neighbors provided them with goods and livestock and free will offerings. And then when we get down to the bottom, we read that altogether that the king himself also gave 5,400 articles of gold and silver. And these were all brought, that when God begins to work, generosity flows. When God works in our hearts, it leads us to give him glory, not ourselves. When God begins to work, it pulls us together. When God begins to work in our hearts, we and others become more generous. We stop asking, what can the church do? We start saying, what can I give? So Melville Presbyterian Church, as you continue to pray and seek the Lord for a restart on your ministry and begin to reach out to your community and serve it in the name of Jesus, let's remember that restart is going to begin first in each one of our hearts. Hearts that give glory to God, hearts that desire to work together, and hearts that lead by being generous. Let's pray together this morning in conclusion. Let's bow our heads as I pray the pastoral prayer. Tender and loving God, you formed the earth to be a place of joy and abundance for all your creatures, for food in all of its variety, and the people who grow it, transport it, market it, and prepare it. We give you thanks. We pray for those who cannot afford enough food, and for those whose agricultural supply is at risk through extreme weather, uncertain prices, and social upheaval. Help us care for the earth and its fruitfulness, and for each other in our common need of its fruits. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all the nations, you gather people together in communities to care for each other and enjoy each other's company and creativity. Thank you for the support we find in our congregation and for the difference volunteers make in our community. Wherever there is division in the world, bring unity and peace with justice. Where people dispute opinions, give wisdom to see what is important. Where people are tired and anxious, bring strength and courage. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, you call us to be communities held together by prayer and love for our neighbors. Thank you for the ministry that has blessed us through the concern others showed us, where people mourn loss of any kind, provide comfort. Where there is illness and pain, bring healing. Where there is distress or discouragement, transform fear into hope, so that your compassion touches life with love and mercy. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we offer you our prayers, spoken and unspoken, in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Melville Presbyterian Church, whether you're online or here in the sanctuary, walk in the light of God's word as you leave our worship. Look around at the seeds bearing fruit around you and consider how you bear the fruit of God's word in your life. May God the Spirit bring you growth. May God the Son tend you with wisdom. May God the source of all life bless you and give you all you need to thrive. Amen and amen. Have a great Sunday.